Yes, welcome to Myles From Home. I'm your host, David Myles. What did you think about that? Got a little bit of a theme song going on now. Yeah, we're leveling up each week. Really happy to be with you. How's everybody doing? How's everybody doing at home? Welcome to my home in Fredericton, New Brunswick. That's where I'm coming to you from. I can see your comments over here on the right, so please feel free to say hi. Hopefully you can hear me well. I look okay. I'm really excited for tonight because tonight I'm going to get to chat with Alan Doyle, the legendary Alan Doyle. I mean, he's a star. My kids are always asking, is he famous? Yes, Alan Doyle's famous. And you know what? I admire Alan Doyle so much. And I'll tell you why. He's hardworking. He's positive. But more than anything, I think probably more than anyone on the East Coast, anyone that I know, he's one of those people that reminds you how great it is to be an entertainer. How lucky we are to be in the entertainment business. It's so easy to spend time, you know, complaining about being on the road or staying in lousy hotels or, you know, being away from our family or nerves, being nervous and the stress that goes along with making records and the industry itself. And you know what? Alan's one of those guys that just isn't like that. He doesn't seem to be like that. He's positive. He's always out there. He sees it as being a privilege to be in front of the audience. And I admire that so much, and it inspires me. And you know what's really inspiring about it is that it translates in all parts of his life. Look at where we are now in a pandemic. Here's a guy that seems to enjoy touring more than any other musician I know. I mean, this guy knows how to throw a party, folks. He knows how to throw an amazing party. It's what he's been doing for decades all across the world. All across the world. And now a pandemic hits. And what does he do? He writes a book. He writes a book that we're going to talk about tonight. Here it is. It's called All Together Now by Alan Doyle. Wicked, wicked book. Take a good look at that. I got it's a little pre-copy. That's why it's got this nice little bound area on the side. Amazing book. He does much the same thing he does on stage, but through humor, self-deprecation, and really well-written stories. He tells stories about being on the road, about being a dad, about living in St. John's and traveling around Newfoundland, Labrador, all around the world. It is so cool to read this book, and I've enjoyed it so much. So that's what we're going to do tonight. And you know what? What makes this extra special is that Myles From Home tonight is being presented by the Frye Festival in Moncton. It's so cool to get to do this. Sure, we can't all be in Moncton at the Frye Festival. We can do this together. It is an amazing literary festival. If you don't know about it, you should look it up, the Frye Festival, F-R-Y-E. So thank you very much to the Frye Festival for doing this. Thank you very much to Tidewater Books. Tidewater Books in Sackville, New Brunswick, a wonderful bookstore. They have autographed copies of Alan's new book there. And thank you also to Doubleday Canada. Thank you to Doubleday Canada for arranging this, for allowing me the time and giving me the opportunity to chat with Alan and for all of us to get to hang out tonight on a rainy, rainy Tuesday night in Fredericton. It is seriously rainy. My kids are sleeping upstairs, but they're chill. They're real good. So how's everybody doing? Let me see. Hopefully everybody's, I see. Not everybody's got the book yet, but you know what? Get it. There's still time. There's lots of time. And it's called, as I said, All Together Now, but there's a subtext. It's called A Newfoundlander's Light Tales for Heavy Times. That's exactly what it is. I was reading this at the breakfast table morning after morning, just absolutely howling. So I hope everybody's feeling good. I hope everybody's ready. I'll try to do my best to keep an eye on the questions if you got any questions. But ultimately, I get into the conversation. You know how it goes if you've watched the show before. And I kind of lose myself. So if I don't notice you, it might take me a sec. So shall we? Let's call up Alan, see how he's doing, see if we can get him on the line here. Oh, I think he's coming.
Hello.
There he is, the man. How are you, buddy?
You look good. Nice to be here. Thanks so much for having me. Hello, everyone.
Oh yeah, what do you think? See, I got all dressed up. We
Man,
had about 20 minutes between the test, and there I went.
I put on my clean hoodie, and I'm
Good.
grateful to be here. Thanks so much.
Good man. Oh man, it's great to have you here. I'm glad we get to do this.
Me too. Thank
You
you very
know,
much.
and you know what? I was just saying in the intro, one of the things I've always appreciated and admired about you, and this is I really do admire this a lot, is the fact that you have been one of those people that reminds us all in the entertainment business that it's an honor to be in the entertainment business. It's a
Yeah, it
joy.
is. It's a privilege, man. It's like so many of us, like so many people that you and I both know, did as much work or way more work than you and I did in their bedrooms playing guitar or singing or acting or painting or doing whatever, and never got the opportunity to actually, do it for a living. And I never take it for granted. Like it's a privilege no matter what no matter what circumstance you get to do it under or have to do it under. It's a real joy. Always has been.
Yeah, I mean, I love how that, because it's easy enough to gripe about it too. You know, we also
Yeah.
know people in the industry that's what we do. It's fun, right? You like to complain
Well,
about
yeah, we
the.
get together and complain about the bus rides and the yada yada yada. But it's like, in the end of the day, like Jim Cuddy said to me once when I was early days, and I guess I was trying to seem cool or something, and we were just talking when Great Big Sea would have been opening for Blue Rodeo, like in 1994 or five or something. And I guess I was just trying to be cool, and I said something along the lines of, "Yeah, man, it looks like we're going to be out for another 150 days next year." Eye roll, kind of fake thing. And he said, "What?" And I repeated it. I said, 150 days, He goes like, driving in the bus or whatever. And he goes like, "Yeah, but you get to play music 150 times next year too."
Yeah, really, that's
And
cool.
I never forgot it. And I was just like, "Yeah, that's true. That is so true." And it's such, yeah. So it is a privilege. Like, and my life, of course, is ex extra kind of lucky. Kind of like yours in a way too, now that I think about it, in that we get to wander in these other disciplines in the arts, whether it be broadcasting or whether it be, acting or books or what have you. We find ourselves, in disciplines that are not necessarily in our own back pocket, and like cool friends of ours, who are working on, perhaps a hip hop record or perhaps or a movie or something, and they ask people like me and you to be a part of it. And it's such a joy to be included in your friend's awesomeness, like it's a real privilege.
But what, I mean, are you just inherently kind of a yes guy? That's what I find so interesting about this. You really kind of jump into these projects. Like, I mean, look, most people, when the pandemic hit, especially as you said, 150 days in the year, that's par for the course for you probably, right? Like, that was what it was for 20 something years. Most people would hit the pandemic and they would have been like, all right, time to chill, you know? But that's not really part of the program for Alan Doyle.
Oh no, nothing. I wish I'm trying to change this about myself. I really am a little bit, but nothing terrifies me like a blank calendar. Like just absolutely terrifies me. Like I don't know. Like I just I wish I wish. And I mean, I think if the pandemic teaches me one thing, it might be to be a little bit more at ease with that. And that'd be a good thing for me to not. Because I'm so content to give away a 6 month block of my life a year from now, because I know that that's work, and if as long as I have work that I like doing, then that's it. And I don't want to leave it open, because what if I don't have anything to do? And then what do I do if I don't have anything to do? And that circle of anxiety that I get when I see a blank calendar.
And so is that what happened with, I mean, when this hit, how quickly did you, I mean, when did this start happening? When did the writing of this book start?
It actually came off much. So we got shut down in March, like everyone, and we were the this year was supposed to have 5 different 3 week legs of the Rough Side Out tour. So we started in the western part of Canada, and we finished in Vancouver on March 8th, and we all flew home on March 9th, when the 2 buses and the truck were supposed to roll back to Mississauga from Vancouver, and we were to start on the 18th, and we would do the eastern half of Canada, And then we were to do three legs in the US and actually one more in Europe. So there was to be six legs of touring this year that only one of them got done.
Okay.
And of course, so March and April were just awful for me because all we did was panic and slowly come to realize that this wasn't going to go away like in an hour. Like this was it. We were here for the long haul, and people who I dreamed of working with in the touring business, my whole adult life, I had to call and tell them that I didn't have work for them anymore. And I had to send, you know, crew people home without getting paid, and because I didn't have any work for them, you know, and like I had to send, you know, try to, you know, all it was all about loss, like letting go of stuff. It was heartbreaking, like just for me, you know, because I mean, on top of being thrilled to get to perform for a living, one of the greatest satisfactions of my life is that I get to employ people and engage creative, awesome people, you know, in the band or in the crew or in the, and I take great pride in that. I love that, you know, a few songs I might've wrote down here by someone, you know, a month and a half work in the summer or something, you know, I love that. And it was very difficult for me to let that go, but of course we had to. And then, so I was also working on another book for Random House Canada, Doubleday, and it was had a lot of travel involved. It was going to be some kind of an origins book about, you know, what in the old country might have led to making up Newfoundland, or to make it what it is, you know, kind of thing. And so there was going to be a lot of travel in Ireland and England, and I was looking forward to that, to be honest. But the of course, none of that could happen, so that got canned as well. And around the end of April, Scott and a couple of people at Random House contacted me and asked, is there anything you could do in a hurry? Is there something you could do that we could put out this fall that was, and I said, well, I've always had this idea, never had the title in my mind, but I always had the idea of a short story book that just tracked my contributions to a night at the pub. And like, I would sit on a stool, you know, across from my friends and, you know, in the St. John's Way. I know you know it, where you're trying to get a story in, but you better stand up quick, bud, because there's going to be one quicker than you can get your tongue out, you know. And that's, you know, and well, as I like to say, my favorite party is when I look around and all the mouths are moving, and it's like, it's just great. And it's just like, no one's listening. It's great. And so that, and really and truly, that's what All Together Now is. And so I said, look, I have this idea. I've had it in my arse pocket for a while. About a pub book, basically a book of stories that you would tell at the pub. And I think I could do that fairly quickly because I think I know what it would be. And they said, well, basically you have 4 weeks. Can you do it in the month of March?
Okay.
So I wrote it in May. Yeah.
So again, you just said yes, because that's the kind of guy you are. You just said, let's do it.
Yeah. But you awesome. Know what I've come into, Dave? Honestly, like one of the things I as more and more I've come to realize something, that's weird about me, and yet I like doing is, which is so odd, and it bites me in the ass more often than it you know buys me anything. Is that like, and I'll describe it for you in a way that I in a sort of an interview, if you will, I had about producing a kids record. This group called Splash and Boots, amazing kids group from Ontario, wanted to do like a Celtic kind of record. And they said, we'd like for you to do it. And I said, well, look, let's talk about it. I mean, let's go. I mean, I don't know. Let's talk about it and see if you dig, you know, what I have to say and whatever. Let's not, you know, I don't know. I don't want to do it if you guys don't want me to, you know, if we don't think it'll work or whatever. So anyway, we had a conversation for, you know, an hour, me and them and their manager, and it all was great. And it looked like it'd be super fun to do. And I said, cool. They were like, they were so excited. And I was so excited. And it was all great. And I turned and I said something that I probably shouldn't have said, but it was so true. I just had to say it. And I turned to them and said, you know, I just want you to understand. The only reason I want to do this is because I don't know how.
Right. And an opportunity to learn.
Yeah. I don't know. You know, and I'm thrilled by that lately in my life is like, and maybe I always was. But it's just like I'm super thrilled now to do stuff that I've never done before, and I'm super stoked to work with people I've never worked with before, and I'm stoked to do, you know, just to do stuff and try it. And like, if it don't work, sure, I mean, it's fine. You know, it's like, you know, like, you're, what else? You know, like, I've done lots of stuff that was awful before, and there'll be lots of awful stuff
yet. You know what? It's just, it's so refreshing to hear you say that. And so it's just like, it's such a great perspective because it does get you into so many different things and to great success. Like, this is a great book. You're obviously a great storyteller. To translate it into writing is a challenge. You know, it does feel, by the way, I don't often do this, bud, but since we're at the pub together.
Oh, that away. Cheers to you. Good man.
Poured myself a pint. You know what? Because this, it takes place. It feels like you're in the pub and you're telling these hilarious stories. And it kind of, there's a number of them that already, you know, take me to what we're saying. One of my favorite ones early on, because I've never, one of my things about, as I said before, your work ethic has always astounded me, is this idea, okay, let's go. Like, we can go out, stay positive. And I was always wondered, where do you get that work ethic? And I swear, I was reading that story about your dad. You can tell this story about digging out your basement in your house. And I thought to myself, okay, this explains it. Like, this this actually does explain where you get that work ethic from.
Yeah, there was, you know, I grew up in a really basic kind of simplistic house, you know, in Petty Harbor, in this little fishing town, 500 people. And there were very few, you know, there were very few rules in my house. And but one of them was, you know, and it was a golden rule in my house that my mother and father both swore at upon, was the only thing you can't do is nothing.
Right.
So I don't care. You get up out of bed and go do something. What do you want me to do? I don't care. Go out, go do something. And like, and so like, they were terrified that we would be idle. And especially my father with his boys, you know, because we were mad as hatters, even as 13-year-olds, you know, like, and I think he saw that one of the only ways he could possibly, you know, rein us in, me and my brother Bernie, was to keep us constantly busy, you know, like, and so, you know, and God help you if you thought you might get to sleep in on Saturday morning or something, because you know, he'd go borrow a load of firewood for us to carry from the truck and then bring it back to someone, like,
right.
So when this announcement came, when I was trying to remember if I was like, I must have been 14 or 15 or something like that. And my brother must have been, my brother's just about 2 years older than me. That dad said, but we need to dig a basement under the house. And I was like, well, don't you do that first normally? Like when you're building, he's like, yes, probably, but that's what we're doing. And so we did.
Is sitting on rock.
Yeah, primarily rock and mud, thick laid mud on the corner of Skinner's Hill in Petty Harbor. It's still there. And my father and a bunch of fellows in Petty Harbor in the mid 60s, as was very common to do then. And my father's not a carpenter or anything, you know, but they would often, you know, on the weekend or whatever, they'd get a few fellows around and they would, you know, affix a few boards here and there and pour a concrete foundation, which in Petty Harbor normally meant making some kind of footprint of a house to marry to existing bedrock, because Petty Harbor is only bedrock. It's like literally, I used to call it bone rock, and it's the whole harbor is just rock leading to the ocean. You know, like I joked about going to Prince Edward Island for the first time and getting off the Woods Island ferry, and in one opening of my eyes saw more growable soil than I'd seen in my entire young life. And so usually it was like some jagged rock for a third or more of what would become the foundation. And then you just pour, like, say, a U-shape to mate with that. You know, in some cases it would be a couple of feet deep, and maybe on the front and the lower side of the hill it would be 4 or 5 feet deep, you know. But that's all the houses in Petty Harbor were like that, you know, and that's how they all went. And then, you know, only later in life as we grew in as a family, Dad wanted that space, I suppose. So, which meant for about half, he wanted to make, you know, 2/3 or more of it usable. So for a third or more of that space, it meant like digging up this thick, like compressed mud that had been there for centuries. And in the rest of it, it was rocks. Like, it was just rock that we had to, you know, we started beating it off with a sledgehammer, and then we got with mallets and stuff. And then we looked into a fellow with a sledgehammer, or, you know, a jackhammer, sorry. And we thought we'd hit the jackpot then altogether. But yeah, that was just, it, you know, and it was a function of where I grew up. in that kind of thing for you and me to read right now sounds fantastical, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody did that where I grew up.
Right.
You know, we left our houses as 11-year-olds with a bucket and a knife from 6 o'clock in the morning in the summertime until mid-afternoon.
Right.
And we went to Round the Wharf and cutting out cod tongue. Imagine sending your 11-year-old out the door with a sharp knife and a bucket. Now, I mean, you'd be put in jail, like, you know, and right. But I mean, we did that. And it was like, you know, was it hard? It was like, well, I certainly didn't think it was then because everybody was doing it.
Right.
And you got this where all your buddies were. You got to go down on the wharf, running around on boats with the fishermen cursing and, you know, talking about girls and stuff like that. It was amazing. You know, it was like, right. Are you just thinking, are you kidding? Like in my adult life, even my university life, people would say stuff like, you know, did you go on vacations in the summer? I was like, what are you talking about? You wouldn't dare leave Petty Harbor in the summertime. It was
so awesome. Coming to town was a big deal. Like it's a different existence in St. John's.
Oh yeah, and it's about 20 kilometers away. And where I'm coming to you from now is deep in the heart of town.
Yeah.
Right, St. John's, like total towny conversion, complete and like so. But it might as well be a million miles away, especially because we didn't have a car or anything, you know. So. Yeah, it's really a rural Newfoundland upbringing in every sense of the word. And the charming thing in retrospect that, you know, stories like the basement digging or in some previous books I talked about working on the wharfs and all that stuff is that I had no idea until I started writing books about it even that those days on a wharf in 1980 in Petty Harbor taught an 11-year-old lessons that would be valuable to him as a 51-year-old in Stockholm.
Right.
You know, like who would imagine that that is even possible? That you know what I mean? That could be worth something.
What do you feel like were the main lessons that you took?
Hard work. Get up earlier. Work well with others, and you'll make more. You know, it's, you know, if you're fair and honest with everyone, then everyone will be fair and honest with you. You know, if you try harder, things will come to you. Luck will be made by your effort. Everything from, you know, it's a possibly an overstatement, but I don't think it is. As 12-year-olds, we participated very actively in the economy of our town.
Yeah, right.
And that's not, I mean, we did. Uh-huh. We were part of the engine that drove our town, you know, and because we were cutting out cod tongues and selling them. But without us, the fishermen had no one to clean their boats, and we cleaned their boats in exchange for the cod tongues. And then, so, you know, they might even get to do a second run, which made more, you know, and it was just like, we were a cog, we were a part of it, you know, and it was like, it was awesome. Like,
well, and it makes singing feel pretty good too.
Oh, when I got 15 or 16, I did, I worked in the crab plant night shift a few times and this, that, and then, but I also started playing in my Uncle Ronnie's band. I'll tell you right now, there was no wondering why I picked one over the other. I'll tell you right now.
It was, you just recognized how darn fun it was.
Yeah. And I also kind of realized I loved it and I loved playing in the band with my uncles and being like, acting like a 25-year-old when I was 15, you know, like, because, you know, they were all lifer cover band guys who played up and down to fishing halls and that up in the Southern Shore. And then I was the young guy who started the next generation Doyle, who started in a long line of Doyles. As I explain to people all the time, I was born into the Doyles in Petty Harbor, and the Doyles in Petty Harbor are the band. They were the band. Before I was born, they're going to be the band long after I'm dead. Like they're the band, you know, like, and so the musical part of it for me came very easily. Like it was just, I didn't even know I was learning the lessons I was learning. And I got to, you know, when I was 15 years old, I was really, by the time I was 15, I was a full-time member of a band that played 50 or 60 times a year.
Okay. Wow. You know? And you're playing rhythm guitar, singing?
Keyboard. I had my DX21 because I couldn't afford a DX7. And I had my uncle's Fender Stratocaster that's hanging on the wall. I'm looking at it right now. And that I bought off him for $400. And a variety of amplifiers over the year. And I I started way, as I explained in the book, I started way over on the side of the stage, which is exactly where you should start, and inched my way to the center by the time Great PC started.
Yeah, and so what did you learn in those early days by watching from the side? What were the big lessons that you watched? Because those bands have got to work. They got to work. Yeah. They got to be good.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you had to put on a show, and you had to do... I mean, most of the stuff with my Uncle Ronnie's band was all in what you know, it wasn't the pub culture, right? The Southern Shore and the rural Newfoundland doesn't really have a pub culture the way St. John's does. Those communities all have what is, was more akin to like a Legion bar.
Okay.
Than a, you know, what in Nova Scotia or, you know, the rest of the Maritimes might see as like a, you know, almost like a, what you'd see in Cape Breton as like the fire hall place or something.
Kind of,
you know,
like an open dance hall stage.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so there was, your job was really to fill the dance floor, figure out what people, what would make people dance, and then make them dance, right? And so, you know, that was really, because the more they danced, the more the fellas bought beer and the more kept them from fighting and stuff, you know. So the dance floor was, if you could fill the dance floor and keep it full, you would be rewarded for it. And my Uncle Ronnie and his gang were always the best at it. They were just... You know, they just knew that the sequence of songs to play that would keep people there, and when to put a waltz in and when not to, and when to take out, lay down the electric guitar and pick up the accordion and that kind of stuff. You know, like, so it was a real like a apprenticeship.
I was gonna say, you're taking notes from the side of the stage. You're kind of going
constantly, yeah.
And you knew at that point that that's eventually you wanted to move into the center.
Not really, to be honest with you. I really, even when Great Big Sea started, I mean, Sean was the singer of the band, like before the band that existed before Great Big Sea called Rankin Street, and he's amazing, like, you know, like, and they were a huge band in downtown St. John's, like they owned the place, you know, and they saw me play in some pub gigs and asked me to join a new band because I could play guitar, you know, and I knew a bit about rock and roll more than even traditional music at the time. And I could write songs, and they figured they needed those things, I guess. And then I was in the band, and I mean, even on the first Great Big Sea record, I think I only sing two songs, you know. Wow. It was just like, yeah, it was just a slow inching towards the center.
Yep.
Like all the while. And I always thought that I would be, my joke is, I always thought I'd be Eddie Van Halen, but I ended up being David Lee Roth.
Not bad. Not bad. Crazy
it.
From the heat.
I'll take it.
Crazy from the heat. Also an author.
You know, book, actually.
That's, but I mean, it's also cool to hear you say that this band of your uncle's was kind of so good at keeping the dance floor going, keeping the party going, because I remember as a kid hearing about Great Big Sea coming through Fredericton.
Yeah.
You know, because I have older brothers.
Yeah.
And they would go to Dolan's, and it was just like,
oh yeah,
like what just happened? This band came to town, and yeah, we partied like there's never been a party before.
Yeah,
you know.
Well, I think one of the and again, like I talk about it in the book about the different stages of my life and what's required of you as a front guy or as a band or what have you, and how when. You know, all my young life, my apprenticeship was in dance bands, you know, like my uncle's bands who filled the dance floors and these Legion halls and fishermen's clubs and stuff. And then I came to St. John's and all of a sudden it's a pub culture. And for 2 years, I played solo gigs at Trapper John's and the Rose and Thistle. And so I sang, you know, 150 songs a night. You know, I got up there at 10 o'clock and played till 2 o'clock in the morning without taking a break. And knew every Stan Rogers song and every Dylan song and every, you know, like Beatles song, whatever, you know, like,
yeah, yeah,
whatever the night wants done, as I say in a song, you know. And it's just like, and then when Great Big Sea started, of course, it was a different beast altogether again, because we were going around Atlantic Canada that had a really, really formalized sort of show pub. Now, we never really had that, like the lower deck, you know, is the king of it, right? Like that kind of what I call a show pub. Like, yeah, it's a pub, but you're really there for music,
yeah,
right? And like you go there because the band is there. And if the band wasn't there, there wouldn't be anyone there, you know, like. And so that's an odd thing. And that was it couldn't have been more perfect for Great Big Sea.
I see.
Because we had spent a year in St. John's, you know, competing with the dart league and the gambling machines and the such and such, like every pub band does, learning to catch people's attention and sell beer. Like, we were the best at selling drinks. My God, we were, pub owners loved us.
Yeah, right.
Like, 'cause we, you know, sociable, sure, go ahead. Yeah, whatever. Great. Like, you know, like, and so every pub owner, they fought for us.
Right.
Because we were so good at that part of it, you know? And that, so by the time we got to Nova Scotia, New Brunswick and Prince Edward Island, you know, like playing, like I say, Dolan's or playing the deck in Halifax or over at Liam's place there, the old Dublin in Charlottetown. I mean, these pubs have like real stages, like, and like people.
And people are facing you and are ready to go. Right.
Jesus Christ, they're already listening. By the time you get up there, like, and so we had played so many gigs that we were ready to blow the doors off the place.
Awesome.
And so we did.
I think that happens a bit with Newfoundland. I mean, I remember even, you know, other bands from Newfoundland, like Hey Rosetta, you know, a band, just, they were great. By the time they started playing in other cities, they were already great because they'd played in Newfoundland for a long time. Like, they were export ready.
I have a theory about that, and I don't know if I'm right, but I'd be curious to, you know, and it's not really apropos our conversation tonight, but I can't help but talk to you about it because we're here. To all the other people watching, I'm so sorry. That I haven't. And it goes as follows. Atlantic Canada, for almost every band in North America, is a place that they would like to get sometime. Right? Be cool, right? To go out to Halifax, that'd be cool, says the band from Kelowna or Toronto or what have you.
Totally, yeah.
That'd be cool. I'd like to go. My cousin was out there once, said it was fun, you know, or whatever. Like, that'd be great. Like, and it's this thing that, you know, well, it'd be great to go out there. I'm sure I would love to do that, you know? If you're a band from Newfoundland, like Great Big Sea or like Hey Rosetta or whomever, the most important city in your career for the rest of your life is Halifax, Nova Scotia.
Wow, right.
You absolutely have to have it.
Wow.
It is not some place you would like to go sometime. But like, as I explain in the Newfoundlander in Canada book, draw a 5-hour circle around, you know, driving circle around 5 or 6 cities in Canada, right? And include the way I say is take, randomly pick Guelph, you know, just say take Guelph, right? And say, okay, where can you go in any direction? How many towns of, say, 30,000 people can you cross in 5 hours driving from Guelph?
Yeah, lots. Tons.
Probably 12, 15.
Yeah, tons. Yeah.
Okay. And go, how many can you get to from St. John's?
None. One?
No.
Yeah,
none.
Right. Yeah,
none.
That's it.
Okay, now double it.
Yeah, right. Then you're in Corner.
The band from Guelph is in New York now.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You know what the number is for St. John's? None.
Right.
Now, add another. I can tell you what. Double it again.
Wow.
So now you're up to 20 hours. How many cities of 30,000 or more do you think the band from St. John's has driven through yet?
Wow.
None.
Seriously?
None.
How big's Corner Brook?
Less 20? than 20 now.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. Yeah, that's a trip, man.
None.
That's a trip.
Right. And so it's like, you know, and it's like people say, well, Yellowknife is. I said, well, go ahead, draw a 20-hour circle around Yellowknife.
Yeah, you're in Edmonton.
You see Edmonton in it? Yep. There you go. Like,
yeah. Wow. Yeah, that's interesting.
Halifax, Nova Scotia. Man, oh man, you've got to have it. You've got to have it. And like, that's why when we showed up and the lower deck was there, we went, oh my God. Not only is it, this is perfect for us. It's absolutely perfect.
Like, so it started cooking pretty quick once you hit the main. Yeah. Like once hit the main. Yeah. Okay.
Because we were just perfect. We could just do everything that the night needed done there.
Right.
And yeah, it was great. But.
Well, you know, there was another part of your book that I loved. I really, really liked this idea of performance, of being on stage. And since we're talking about the apprenticeship and all this, of being a mix between confidence and humility.
Yeah.
I thought that was really smart because we always talk about the confidence, right?
Yeah.
We always think about it as being that.
Yeah.
And the humility part is so interesting, knowing that you're there because of other people. I remember Ron Hines said it to me. We did a show out West one time. I think it was during the Olympics. And he turned to me and said, David, it's not about getting the audience to love you. It's about you, making the audience understand that you love them. And I was like, man, that's so interesting.
Every band needs a crowd, man.
It's so interesting.
Yeah. And I mean, it's just my own like sort of observations to date about it, as I describe in the book, is it's a combination of bravado and humility, and every night it's a mixture of the two. But here's the trick: you never know what percentage of either one you will need until you get out there. Most times, you know, like you might think you do, and then that's a pitfall, you know, and that we all fall into, and it's like. And there's, you know, there's such a one of the things I'd love to write about, and I just don't know how to do it yet, is like the things that are happening in your mind when you're fronting a band. Like, you know, and how many things other than the song you're singing are happening. You know what I mean?
It's good to know that that's not just me. Because,
You know, you're just going like, well, I wonder, you're looking at the set list going, shit, I shouldn't play that one.
That's
next.
Right.
And you're going, oh, man, you know. I forgot that Dougie asked me not to do this in F sharp because his pedal is broken for the F sharp one, or, you know.
But there's like, so many pace changes that need to take place when you need to tell a story, and all of this. I just thought it was really interesting because it is an interesting, because of that bravado thing is obviously what we focus on when we think of a front man of a band.
Yeah.
But those moments where you can make an audience understand that you love them, that this is what you enjoy doing, and that you feel it's kind of from the beginning of this conversation, it's this idea that you feel like it's a privilege to get to do this.
Yeah.
And even the biggest bands in the world still do that when they do it well. I remember when I saw Prince in Halifax, and Prince, like biggest star in the world. Everybody knows he's one of the best ever. Right. But it was like, he was the opening act.
Yeah. Humility. Yeah. It's just so endearing, isn't it?
It was the best. He wanted to make everybody know him and love. And like he made it, everybody feel like, yes, I'm in Halifax. I'm so happy to be here. And I was like, whoa, I didn't know that was coming.
Yeah. It's so beautiful when I missed, I really wanted to go to that concert. I know the one you're talking about was like 5 or 6 years ago. Right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And everyone I know who's seen Prince said it was the best concert they've ever seen in their life. And I would have loved to have seen him. I'm sad that I didn't get to see him. And yeah, I mean, I think that the first thing that you should say, the first, you know, thing that people should feel from you when you walk on stage is gratitude. And the last thing you should say to people before you leave is thank you.
Right.
And if you don't mean it both times, you're in the wrong business.
Right. Yeah, I like that. I mean, I agree with that. And I think the audience feels that. That's obviously, it's been a huge part of your career. But also, I think what's interesting about it is if you believe it, then it fuels it. Then it fuels the work, right? Because it's not like you're not faking it. If you stop believing that, it gets a lot harder to go up.
You're in the wrong
business.
Like, you know, don't. If you love the work will save you, and the work is all you'll ever need. And if you're in it for the money, there'll never be enough money. And if you're in it for the babes, there'll never be enough babes. And if you're in it for the sex and drugs and rock and roll, there'll never be enough sex and rock and roll. If you don't love the work, please stop.
Right.
You're going to torture yourself.
Do you find, like, I'm curious because a lot of these conversations I have with people is about what they do to recharge when they're not working. You know what I mean? What is it for you that I mean, obviously you get a lot from the work itself. It fuels you. But what fuels you outside of the work that gives you that energy to go right back at it?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I've never, one of the questions I get asked all the time is, how do you get up for the gigs? I have to calm down for the gigs.
Yeah, right.
I never have to get up for the gig. I got backstage going like trying to calm myself, singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow as slow as I can, because I'll go out and play all the songs. You know, poor Chris McFarlane, who you know and love as well, has been our drummer for my whole adult life. He's been tortured, of course, because trying to keep me from speeding up. Good luck with that. I find that the other parts of my life just give me things to talk about when I'm up there, like, you know, and I've always loved, you know, the opportunity to go to a town. It was when the tour bus showed up and we got out of the van, it was the greatest thing ever happened, because you roll into the town at 10 o'clock or 8 o'clock in the morning and you got at least a couple hours to go explore the town, which is both healthy and good for you. But it also gives you great stuff to talk about on stage.
Yeah, right.
You know, so that whole notion that you can tell people you had a personal experience in their town that day. You know, so I don't find, I guess to answer your question in a long way, is that I don't find I need much to fuel it, you know? As a matter of fact, I need things to kind of cool it down a bit.
Wow.
You know, because if I'm not careful, I'm totally happy to just do that, you know, 6 nights a week all year long. And most of my adult life, knock on wood, lucky, you know, part of, you know, my manager, Louis, and I was just like, look, if Alan will kill himself, like,
right.
you can't. You need to, he's like, you know, he's like a horse you got to rein in, or, you know.
Okay. I wondered that. I wondered how it works with management in terms of just pacing you, because you'll say, I mean, there's part in the book when you talk about flying.
I cannot tell you how often my manager and my team said, I think that's enough, man. I think that's, I'm worried that's too much. And I'm like, I'm grateful for that. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I love the part in the book where you go from playing the Junos, which I remember that performance. I remember it well. You closed out the Junos, which I didn't know. It was great performance. Super fun.
Yeah, and then,
but what no one else knew is that you got on a plane right after and flew to film Robin Hood with Russell Crowe.
Yeah, same day. Yeah, it was one of the craziest 24 hours of my life, because we were closing the Junos with Great Big Sea and Hawksley. And another band called Echo Deck or something like that, like a esoteric kind of synthy band. I can't remember what they're, forgive me, I can't remember what they were really creative and cool. And Echo Deck, was that what it was? Anyway, and we played, because Great Big Sea had done a cover of, you know, of the Zeppelin's cover of Gallows Pole.
Yeah, I remember.
You know, and it was like, it was so cool, because we're just sort of like, we're just up to the huge rock moment, you know, and I loved it. And it was like, we got off stage and everybody loved it. And it was like, holy shit, we just closed the Junos. And it's like, Mr. Doyle. And I looked over and there's a guy there, like almost like an undertaker driver going, like, and I was like, yeah, to the airport. And like, I think I was in an airplane before the hockey rink emptied.
Insane. You know,
and I'm flying overnight too. And I couldn't sleep. I was so freaked out. And so I didn't sleep a wink, and I flew to Heathrow, and got picked up at the airport at whatever that would be, say 7 in the morning or 6 in the morning or something, because you fly over the pole then. You used to.
So it was, from Vancouver, right.
It only took, I thought it would take like 13 hours, and it took like 6 and or something. And anyway, went right to set, walked right on, off we go, right on, you know. And there you are, Alan Adale, with the loot hanging off your back, doing a scene in a Ridley Scott movie with Russell Crowe and Kate Blanchett. And hey guys, hello.
Yeah. I mean, talk about doing things that you know, jumping into situations where you don't know what you're doing at first. Like, you didn't have much. Did you have acting experience before that?
No, not a clue. No. And, it was an amazing experience, of course. Like, and I was so grateful, like in retrospect, I'm so grateful that I thought very quickly that it was no sense in me dwelling on the gap between my movie making experience and the movie making experience of everybody else who was around, because it was just, that's not going to do anyone any good, including me.
Right.
So I'll just go there and I will bring all the talents I have and all the skills I have, and I'll keep my eyes and ears open. I'll do whatever I can to try to make the project better, you know. And like, and one of the reasons they wanted me to do it is because I could play the lutes and the medieval stuff, but also because I could write songs on the spot, you know. And they wanted the Alan Adale character to be the news, you know. And so, you know, so.
Right.
Because that's the way they imagined the troubadours of the day, right? They're the guys going around singing the parody songs about the king or the, you know what I mean? And they would be the ones who would entertain people in the night times, but they would also, you know, have the satirical song about some lady with, you know, huge cans or whatever to make the soldiers laugh or whatever, right. You know, like, and so that, and so I just, every scene I was in, I had two songs written for it before I got there, you know, it's just like, and, I'll just in case they need something, like, you know, and so I was lucky to have those ready in a couple of cases. Like there's a song, how's it go? It goes like that, a shanty or whatever. And it's wrong, we bully boys, we're in a hurry, boys, we got a long way to go. We'll sing and we'll dance and bid farewell to France, and it's wrong, we bully boys, row. You know, it's like a shanty that the merry men sing when they're leaving France. And it made the movie, and then there was a couple of, like, there's another, the story I tell in the book is of this one, that this little piece of a song that ended up being called Large-Breasted Woman, which was called for upon the spot, and all that kind of stuff that, you know, really and truly that kind of, you know, like I think an actor who was from a long, trained, you know, classically trained actor wouldn't have that skill set. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
To be able to, you know, to write a booby song on command.
You were going back to the pub. I mean, it kind of sounds like, yeah, when you talk about the pub scene, the early, when you were full playing there with guys who were up solo guitar, making people laugh, working on the spot.
Full circle. Yeah.
Right.
Full circle back to the Rose and Thistle, where we, you know, we just sang parody songs and made, you know, made fun of people's jackets as they came in through the door, and, you know, in that McLean and McLean kind of Lambert and James kind of way. Right. And it was like, who knew that if you keep your eyes and ears open, all the lessons of your life will probably help you at some point.
That's nuts. Yeah. What an amazing experience. And you're still buds with these guys, right? I mean, you're still.
Yeah, no, we worked together on a bunch of things, including another. Well, we worked on another movie, a bunch of us in New York a little while later, called Winter's Tale with Colin Farrell and Jennifer Connelly and a bunch. That was really cool because I met Akiva Goldsman, who was the writer and director on Winter's Tale. And then I ended up, he knew me. And so they needed another Irishy fella for that one. So I got that gig. And then myself and Russell have just written a bunch of songs for projects that he's doing and for Great Big Sea and for my own stuff and for television and for Anna Sisters Records and for a whole bunch of stuff. And then, yeah, it's been a really beautiful, like experience and like a relationship, you know, that's a real blessing, man, for someone like me. It's great.
Well, I mean, it's so cool to have those. It is about relationships. It's about relationships.
So, yeah. Yeah. And like just, you know, being grateful, you know, that you get to, you know, have friends who are happy and is, you know, successful in the arts, if you will. And then, like you say, to be invited into their backyard every now and again.
Yeah, yeah, go on the trip. Oh, I mean, I know. My finest experience are those, exactly that, where I'm like, well, how did I find myself in this world?
You know, it's like, it's great. Like, it's just, it's nice, you know, to be invited, you know, and yeah, to the party. And you try to bring something, and if you can, awesome. And, you know, if you know, it's nice to be in the mix. It really,
yeah,
is.
Yeah, but I think it's, you know, it goes back to what you said. There's also a bit of a mix of humility and bravado, a little bit of bravado that you're going to say, okay, I'm ready to jump in, but also being like, I'm ready to make mistakes. If I make mistakes, tell me. I'm going to learn. I'm ready to learn.
What I've been telling people about this book, not to bring it all full circle.
No, it's
but
good.
What I've been telling people about this book is, before they get it, he was like, by no means is what you're about to read a collection of my victories over the years. Quite the opposite. It's really a confessions for my embarrassment and your amusement more than anything. But, you know, I think, you know, and I hope it rings true in the narrative of the book, that there are, you know, there's so much victory in mistakes. Like there's like you're so lucky to have those mistakes in your life. Like you just like, man, oh man, that's the greatest thing that could ever happen to you. Like, is that you shagged it up, you know, like that's awesome. Like, awesome. Like I'm going to go to the next one, you know? And like, you know, you won't shag
get
up,
get back up and keep on rolling.
And it was like,
well, it makes for a hilarious read. It is like the self-deprecating element of it is hysterical.
It is. A couple of them are kind of painful, you know, because there's such just embarrassing things, you know, like about drinking too much, getting tricked by the Scrumpy Jack cider in the UK. Do you know what I'm talking? You know that
Oh
stuff?
Man, that's harsh. I read that and I was like, wow.
I've always prided myself on you know, and not making those kind of mistakes, you know, and not drinking too much or not, you know, not having the, like my joke, or if you will, is like, I never wanted the after show more than the show, you know, and, but that was one time I got tripped up there again. It was really because, as I say in the story, Scrumpy Jack is a goddamn liar.
You know, but what's great about it is that when you talk about making mistakes with that humility, you know, and you're self-deprecating, it brings people in. It makes people feel less alone, right? Because there's lots of times as a performer myself where I'm like, oh, man, I feel like no one else makes mistakes. Why do I make these? Why do I listen to Scrumpy Jack? You know what I mean? Like, why am I in this situation? And then you read a book and you're like, oh my gosh, I feel so much better. Look, everybody's making mistakes. We're all just fumbling through this.
Yeah. And there's a, you know, there's a joy in it. If you can surround yourself with good buds who will like pick you up when you fall down and all that stuff. And it's, I mean, you know, I think it'd be a horrible thing to have none of those, to be afraid to make them. That'd be a horrible thing, you know, to be afraid to make mistakes. Then you're not doing much in your life then, you know.
You're not going to end up doing much. No, and you've given...
Do you know that t-shirt or like you see it on a skateboard or like sometimes you see that thing that says no regrets? You ever see that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I always look at that and go like, what? None? Yeah. Like, I have 8 today. Today. Like, I have 8.
And you gotta stop, buddy. Next time you see him. No, you really?
Like, are you serious? None? Wow. Like,
flawless record.
You're either living a very sanitized life or you're some kind of sociopath. That's what I'm
It's great. But I mean, you've also given, I want to mention another thing just before we finish up, this, your charitable work over the last, well, over the last number of years, but this last year has been unbelievable.
Oh my God, has it ever? It's been just a joy. And again, like another bright light in the darkness. Yeah, we started this foundation called A Dollar a Day. And it's a very simple thing that started very organically here in St. John's, because we had our studio in Great Big Sea down on the other end of downtown. And I lived over where I live now on the other side. So like I live closer to the, you know, where the Sheraton Hotel is, we'll say. And then the Great Big Sea studio was down closer to where the Delta is, like down on the other side of St. John's. And so I used to walk the length of Water Street every day. We were doing this record. And I always stopped chatting to this guy on the street who was looking for money. And I gave him $1 every day. And I learned about his mental health and addictions issues and stuff. And, you know, when records in bands can be stressful and stuff to make, and it just became kind of a peaceful part of my day that I felt good about, you know. And like, so I when the band went on the road and the record was done, I wondered how I could give that guy $1 a day without being there. So I just started saving $1 every day, and or 4 quarters or something, you know, and I just chuck it in my knapsack somewhere. And I didn't find it very hard, like, to save $1 a day. Like, it was like, well, it's never hard. Like, I got, you know, 10 dimes over there. Yeah. And at the end of the year, I gave it all to one of the mental health and this outreach hospice that's here in St. John's. And then I did that for 2 or 3 years in a row. And I didn't even tell anyone. I just did it. Like, and then I mentioned it to a couple of my friends, Brendan and Andrew, when Christmas. And they said, yeah, we should do that. And I was like, yeah, that'd be cool. And they said, No, we should get everyone to do that. And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, we should start a foundation, an engine that makes it really easy for people to give $1 a day for mental health and addictions. He's like, you just sign up and give us $1 today, and we'll take it, and we'll just take that dollar, and we'll give it to a mental health or addictions facility in your backyard or one of the ones across the country or what have you. And so just over 2 years ago now, we started the foundation, and now we're already supporting one or more facilities or programs in every province and territory of the country. Wow. We're on par to raise, really close to $1 million this year.
That's amazing.
It's just incredible. And we started these supper time sing-alongs where I just come to sit right there. And on Facebook, and I sing some songs, and people sign up to become $1 a dayers, or, you know, we get donations, one-time donations from groups, or sometimes we have a partnership with like Subway or Clearwater, or perhaps a national foundation like like Rogers, for example, helped us up with a couple of things, and then we've managed to give away close to $1 million
this year. Good for you. Congratulations. That's
remarkable. Yeah, it's
I've been watching it. I've been watching it throughout the year, and I'm just like, it's so inspiring and so cool.
It really is for me too. Like, and I'm doing it, and I feel inspired because, of course, I'm just sitting there singing songs. I mean, they're like the dollars that I'm handing over to, be it a drug rehabilitation facility in Gastown, or a PTSD recovery program for first responders in Windsor, Nova Scotia, or an outreach program, street reach program here in St. John's, or a cool outfit in Ontario that sends mental health professionals in cars with the police when they go to calls that might require mental health assistance before actual police intervention, and all these creative and cool ways, or an anti-bullying campaign or what have you, and all these various different things that are manned or woman staffed by these incredible people who are either doing it for very little or volunteering.
Yeah.
They're doing the hardest work that we can imagine at the grossest times of the day. And the least we can do is give them a dollar, man. Like, do you see what they're doing? Like, they've got a knapsack on their back, walking around Gastown, giving out methadone kits.
And easy work.
Oh my God.
So hard.
The least we can do is give them a dollar.
And music is a great way to raise money. I mean, that's the thing. Singing songs is such an amazing way to bring people together to raise money.
Yeah, and to gather people, as you say, even if it's virtually. And for me, I've sort of trumpeted the music business's role in all that for a long time. And I'm not at all shy about saying, I would love to know the amount. Just take Newfoundland and Labrador, just one province. I would love to know that in any normal year, the amount that the music industry raises for charity.
Yeah, right.
It would blow your mind. Yeah. I feel like we punch above our weight in that regard.
Yeah. Yeah, it's because of that role, that role of congregating people towards a good cause and bringing people together. And, and now we can't necessarily be together in the same spot, but we get to hang out like this. And have a beer together.
As you said, we were doing the tech run earlier. You said, "Hey, well, this is what hanging out is now."
This is what hanging out is. Yeah. Alan, thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh man, it's a pleasure to chat to you anytime. And call me tomorrow. Sure, we'll be around now.
I totally appreciate it. And congratulations on the book. You should be super proud of it. It's excellent. It really is. It's awesome.
Thanks so much, man. I'm grateful, and it's nice to talk to you. And next time we get to have a beer, let's do it down by the river in Fredericton, all right?
Sounds good, man. I'll be there. Right on.
Love it.
Thanks so much, buddy. Peace. Thanks. There we go. That was almost strange for a second, but we pulled it through. Hope everybody enjoyed that conversation with Alan Doyle. What an amazing guy. He's so inspiring. He's so positive. Loves to work, doesn't seem to complain at all. He's an amazing individual. We're lucky to have him on the East Coast. You got to check out the book. I hope you've enjoyed this. Say hi over here. Thanks, everybody, for listening. And take care of yourselves. Take her easy. Be kind to yourselves, if I like to say. It's not an easy time, so you got to be kind to yourselves. Be patient with yourselves and be kind to everybody else. And we'll see you real soon. We're going to do this again. I think we might even have Tom Power on the next one. That's what we've been talking about, but talking to Tom. We're going to have him. We got lots of other guests hopefully lined up real soon. We're going to do this. Thank you again to the Frye Festival, Double Day Canada, Tidewater Books for arranging this with Alan. Again, here's his book, Alan Doyle, All Together Now. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. We'll see you really soon. Take care.